Welcome to Google Plus Developers Live. My name is Chris Cartland, and I'm a developer programs engineer working on the Google Plus platform.
And I'm Yaniv. I'm a product manager on the Google Plus platform.
And I'm Lee. I'm also a developer programs engineer on the Google Plus platform in London.
Yeah, thanks for joining us via Hangouts all the way from London. Today is really exciting. We're going to talk about cross-platform single sign-on, which is something you may have seen demonstrated in the I.O. keynote this year. It's a really cool feature. We're going to first talk about what it is, and then we're going to actually show you the code and how that fits into our sample application Photohunt, and we'll show you all the details of how to make sure that you're doing it right, and you can do this in your application. So this is really exciting. First of all, Yaniv, can you tell us a little more about what cross-platform single sign-on really is?
Sure. We recognize that users don't just use one device to interact with your app. They switch between laptops, tablet, and mobile devices on a daily basis. And we're focused on making desktop and mobile work better together, so users will have a seamless experience between platforms. With that, we're taking another step in this direction, we're introducing the cross-platform single sign-on, or as we call it, SSO. Cross-platform SSO lets you connect to users and more easily keep them engaged across devices, removing all the frictions of consent and authentication. Now a user connect on one device and seamlessly they're connected to any other device. Let's look, for example, on a case of a user that logs into your web app and start adding items to their shopping cart. But this user is actually not completing the transaction, doesn't check out. Mm-hmm. If this user already signed in with Google Plus, when using our cross-platform single sign-on, when they go to your web application, they automatically sign into Google without need to consent again or authorize anything, and all of the data is available for them to use, and they can check out from exactly the same place that they were before in your website.
That's really great. So that would mean that they could actually buy something more quickly with less friction in that app.
Exactly.
Make it easier to do what they want to do.
Yeah.
That's great. So yeah, I'd actually love to see how this actually works. So if we can... Lee, I think you can help us out here. First, can you explain a little bit about what Photohunt is? And then once you've done that, we can go into actually the code and how Photohunt's working to do this.
Yeah, sure. So Photohunt is a sample app which demonstrates the Google Plus APIs on Android, iOS, and the web. It's a game. It's a photo scavenger hunt where players capture photos with their mobile devices and cameras, and they submit them to a daily theme. And then other players can vote on their photos to find out which one is the best one. But more than our other sample applications, it's really close to a real-world implementation. So it's much closer to helping you understand what the real-world issues you might face when you try and implement social login in your app. So for example, it implements a client-server architecture. So if you've done that in your own app, then it'll give you an idea of how to do that. It has both a signed out and a signed in experience. So if you're planning to do that in your app, then you can see how that works. And also it does a more real world kind of error handling flow as well. So particularly on the server side, it's a good way to see how that works. So it has a server component which is implemented in Java, and we're planning to add more languages in the future. And it has client implementations in JavaScript for the web and on iOS and on Android. These are all available on GitHub, and also the documentation is available on developers.google.com/plus. So if we take a look at the architecture that you get when you set up a Photohunt instance, then you can see that we get an Android client and a JavaScript client, and each of them authenticate independently with the Google Plus APIs using Google Plus sign-on. And so they can each make direct calls to the Google APIs in their own right, and they can do things like get the user's profile information and get their social graph and all the good things that you want to do. They also authenticate with the Photohunt server, but that is a completely Photohunt specific API. So that's nothing to do with Google. It's a Photohunt specific API, but during that process, they will pass over Google credentials, which the Photohunt server can then use to also make calls to the Google APIs on behalf of the user. So, you know, if you're writing Moments server side, or if you're getting the Social Graph server side to do things with it there, then you can also do that.
Yeah. So for this application, user is going to authenticate either an Android or on the web. In possibly two different places, they may have to see like a consent dialog, and then that information gets passed to the server, and then the server does all the actual API calls with Google, or most
right.
of them.
Exactly. So the for single sign-on, what we're really interested in is that conversation that goes on between the clients and Google, rather than the server and Google. So let's focus on that. When a user signs in with Google Plus sign-in, then it's important that Google, if it's for the very first time for your service, then Google needs to show a consent dialog, which explains to the user the permissions that your app is requesting to be able to access the Google APIs and their data on their behalf. So that consent dialog is displayed natively as part of Google Play Services on Android, and is displayed as part of the sign-in flow on the web. But with Google Plus sign-in, when you consent to those permissions for a given app, you do that to the project, regardless of what platform you happen to be accessing on, which is great news for the developer. So it means, and great news for the user. So it means that if I sign in for the first time on Android for this app, then I'll see the native consent dialog there. But then if I subsequently access the same service via the web, I won't have to consent again. And the same thing happens in the other, you know, vice versa, if you sign in first on the web. So that creates a seamless experience for the user on Android, because the user is already authenticated to the device. So that means that they don't have to type in their username, they don't have to type in their password. And because if they've signed in already on the web, they don't even see the consent dialog, that means that they're dropped straight to a signed in experience in your app without having to click a single button. They get the personalized experience, and also, as Yaniv said, if they've started anything on the web, that state will be available to them immediately in the app.
This goes both ways.
Yeah, and it goes both ways. So, if the user's already signed in for the first time on Android, in a browser, if that's their browser at home, they're likely to be already signed into Google, and that means that when they access the service in a web browser and the sign-in button's displayed, it will attempt an immediate mode authentication. And because they've already consented on Android, that will go ahead. And again, they'll be signed in without having to click a single button. And they get all the benefits that way as well.
That's really great. And it's really, really a neat thing that we're able to bring this together on Android and the web and make those two more seamless.
Yeah. Now, the great news for developers is that you don't need to make any special changes. You don't have to do anything special in your app to actually implement single sign-on. It's taken care of for you. But what I'm going to do is take us through the Android code for Photohunt and explain what's going on behind the scenes to make single sign-on happen. So in Android, as we know, the sign-in is handled by the Plus client, which is our interface to Google Play Services. And typically what we would do is we would tie our Plus client lifecycle to the lifecycle of our activity. Now in Photohunt, because you typically want the same sign-in logic for every activity, what you're going to do is probably either implement a base activity to collect that reusable functionality together, or what we've done in Photohunt is actually put it in a reusable fragment. So let's take a look at Plus Client Fragment. Like I say, this ties the Plus Client's lifecycle to the lifecycle of the activity. So we can see that in the onCreate method of this Plus Client Fragment, we initialize our Plus Client and then we call onConnect. We call connect. We use the Plus Client Builder to create the Plus Client, and what we do here is we set the scopes, which represent the permissions that your app is asking of the user, and we also set the visible actions, which is the app activities that your app would like to write. Now, it's really important that the scopes and the activities that you set are the same across all the platforms. All the platforms that you implement need to match, because if you ask for different scopes on different platforms, then when you log in on the web, say after you've already logged in on Android and you're asking for different scopes, Google will have to ask the user for their consent again, because you're asking for a different set of permissions. So if you want SSO to work, you really need to make sure that those scopes match across all the platforms that you implement on.
Mm-hmm. So like you said before, you're not really doing anything new to implement single sign-in. We're just checking to make sure that you have things set up correctly. So that right now on this screen, we can see the set visible activities and set scopes, and those need to be the same on Android and the web and across all your platforms.
Yeah. So of course, when you're implementing on multiple platforms, you don't get to define that in a header somewhere where you can use it everywhere. It's really a developer job. You've got to make sure that those are the same across the different platforms. So at the end of that onCreate method, we call connect, just as we would regardless of single sign-on. And that does two things. It will attempt sign-on immediately, and it will attempt to fetch the sign-in state of the user. Mm-hmm. And to do that, it needs a connection to Google Play Services, which is the other thing it will set up. And that call is asynchronous, and will ultimately come back to onConnected if the user has approved our app anywhere on any platform, and we've got a successful connection to Google Play Services, then that will come back in onConnected. And if it fails for some reason, then it will come back in onConnection fail. So that's no different for single sign-on. So Plus Client, of course, integrates with the Android Account Manager, and that means that it already knows about the Google accounts on the device. And also whether they are authenticated in terms of typing in the username and password. So all that we need to do is decide which account we need to use and whether or not that account has approved our app. Now that gives us several possible states that we can be in. So you can see here that if none of the accounts on the device have approved our app, then we're going to get on connection failed regardless, right? I mean, that might mean, you know, if they haven't haven't chosen an account, then we might show them an account chooser. But whatever else happens, we're going to have to show them a consent type. So that's fine. That's what the user would expect. But if they've authorized our app on any platform, on the web or Android, then we can see on the left-hand side that we've got a number of options open to us. So in the common case, in the case where there's only one Google account on the device, then that would be chosen. It would be the default account for the app. And they would get authorized immediately. And the next thing that happens is that onConnected is called, and our app drops into its signed-in state, which is great. If their user does actually have more than one Google account on the device, then it gets a little bit more complicated, but it's still handled. So here what happens is, if exactly one of those accounts has authed our app, then again, we'll get the single sign-on experience. It will choose that account as the default account, and then we'll get dropped to onConnected, which is great. If more than one of those accounts has authorized our app, then we don't know which one the user needs to pick. So we have to at least show them a chooser. We won't show them a consent dialog once they pick, but we have to show them a chooser. So either way, that's a pretty seamless experience for the user.
And clearly there is the case where you've never authorized, so that there's no, you haven't even signed on once with the app, so you can't do single sign-on in that case.
Exactly. So if you've never signed in anywhere, then you're going to get that on connection failed regardless.
But once you've done once, you end up in the left column. And then it's really just a matter of whether the user has multiple accounts on that device. And Google tries to make a good decision, but you know sometimes you have to.
And actually, the same thing happens on the web as well. So if the user is signed into their browser with multiple Google accounts, then they'll get an account chooser there as well. So the logic is the same across all platforms. We handle that case with multiple accounts, but the common case is one account and there is. So the last thing I wanted to talk about was when the user signs out. So here, if you've implemented sign in before, you know that what we do in sign out is we clear the default account, and that forces the account chooser to appear when they sign in a second time. Now, Google Play Services remembers whether or not for this app we have carried out the single sign on flow. What you'd expect is that when the user signs out, they'll see that account chooser regardless of whether the single sign-on flow would have caused one of them to be signed in. And that still works. So you have to remember that Google Play Services remembers that. And particularly if you're debugging, it's a good idea when you want to test single sign-on to go in and clear the state in Google Play Services. So that will force the single sign-on flow to happen again for the app. Mm-hmm. Good tip there. That really creates a seamless experience for the user. You as a developer are doing exactly what you would have done before. You're implementing onConnected to be your signed in experience. You're implementing onConnection failed to be your signed out experience. And you really do exactly the same, and Google Play Services takes care of everything else for you. If the user is signed in as a result of single sign-on, they will get that toast message to say that welcome back to the app, and so they're not surprised by the fact that they're signed in. But from your app's perspective, it just works exactly the same. So that's all I had to say about the Android implementation. Colin, do you want to take us through the JavaScript implementation?
Yeah, great. Yeah, I'm going to briefly look at the JavaScript for Photohunt as well. And we forgot to talk a little bit about the on connection failed. That is the same thing that you would have had before, and that will help to get the user through that the rare case where they have multiple apps that have authorized.
Yeah.
Great. Moving on to the JavaScript. The first thing that you need to make sure you've set up right is the sign-in button, which in Photohunt is done through gappy.signin.render. We have several fields that we configure with the sign-in button. And the ones I really want to call out are the request visible actions and the scopes. We want to make sure that those are the same as the ones that Lee talked about in Android. Because, of course, if you have different scopes, different permissions, we're going to have to ask users for the new permissions. But once we've set those up, this is, again, the same sign-in button that we had before single sign-on existed. And the user will click on that and authorize. If they've authorized either now on the web or in the Android flow that Lee just described, then the callback will be fired with the authentication and authorization information that you need. So this really has actually no change at this point. We just, Photohunt takes care of knowing who the user is and then, being the app, which is really the key here. We're trying to do all this work so that as a developer and as a user, you can just get to using the app. You don't want to spend time signing in and doing all the other work. You just want to get to Photohunt where you can actually deal with stuff. So that's the stuff there.
Yeah, if you have any more questions, we're welcome to answer them on a Stack Overflow account. Just use Google Plus as your tag. Mm-hmm. You can also see some all of those examples that we discussed today on developers.google.com/plus or on our community on Google Plus for developers.
Yeah, great. So thank you so much for joining us today, and thank you so much, Lee, for staying up late in London to help us
Thanks,
out
Lee.
With this.
Welcome.
And thank you, everyone, for watching. We'll see you next week.